Hi friends, today we will look at the answer for question 22 that I have given yesterday. So 22nd question, if you observe, these kind of questions I would call them as easy questions, because here in a single question they have asked you 5 different aspects. For example, they ask you about how the protocol operationalizes the United Nations Framework Convention of Climate Change by committing the developed countries to reduce the greenhouse emissions. This is one statement that they have given. You may have to explain the statement. Then in this context, they ask you to explain the market-based mechanisms followed by the Kyoto Protocol. First question. And also explain the methods of monitoring the emission targets. Second question. Third question is, what is the Doha Amendment done to the Kyoto Protocol? And fourth question is, compare Paris Agreement with the Kyoto Protocol. So, as they have asked you four different questions, of course, they are related to each other. However, there are 4 different questions. So, for each question, you can just write 2 or 3 points. So that overall, for 4 questions, it would be almost 12 points. You can end the answer. For example, what is a difficult question? If they have asked you only to explain the market-based mechanisms followed by Kyoto Protocol, then it's difficult, because only for that single question you have to write 10 to 12 points, which you may not know. You may require deep knowledge to answer that question. But to answer this question, you just need to require the basic idea, 2 or 3 points about each of them. That's why I call these kind of questions as the easy questions. So anyhow, the point here is, give equal importance and emphasize equally on all the 4 parts of the question. So it is a 15 marks question. You have to write 250 words. That is almost 2.5 pages to 3 pages in the exam, the answer sheet. And you can take 10 to 12 minutes to answer this question. So let us discuss the answer. First, let us explain the statement. Before the statement, let us give introduction. In this kind of questions, I would suggest you to give introduction where you just mention what is UNFCCC and what is Kyoto Protocol, just 2 lines, and then explain the statement. So you can say, the United Nations Framework Convention of Climate Change that happened in 1992 as a part of United Nations Earth Summit. You may be knowing the United Nations Earth Summit that happened in 1992 in Rio de Janeiro. So the basic idea of UNFCCC is that to stabilize the greenhouse gases, as the greenhouse gases are on a rise because of industrial revolution, particularly by the developed countries, UNFCCC wants to stabilize the greenhouse gases, no further increase in the greenhouse gases. So as a continuation of the UNFCCC, Kyoto Protocol has been signed by several countries, almost 194 countries. So Kyoto Protocol believes in the principles of UNFCCC, and it talks about common but differentiated responsibilities and respective capabilities, which means in the world every country has common responsibility to reduce the greenhouse gases. However, common but differentiated, some countries have more responsibility. Why? Historically, some countries have emitted more greenhouse gases, because of which the global warming happened. So those countries have more responsibility. So clearly, Kyoto Protocol gives more responsibility for the developed and industrialized countries which have polluted the world mostly. So what are the various parties to Kyoto Protocol? Kyoto Protocol divided the parties into 3. Annexure 1, Annexure 2, and the third one is simply called developing countries. Annexure 1 consists of the developed and industrialized countries and economies in transition, like, you know, Canada, USA, Australia, Japan, New Zealand, etc. Annexure 2 is a subset of Annexure 1. Some of the countries of Annexure 1 are taken into Annexure 2 to pay for the cost of developing countries. That is the Annexure 2 countries. So you can write 2 lines about this. Now explain the statement given in the question. The statement simply says, Kyoto Protocol commits the developed countries to limit the greenhouse gases. So just write about that. You can say that Kyoto Protocol asks the Annexure B countries to See, NHB countries, almost 37 countries come under that. 37 developed and industrialized countries fall under that. So it asks these countries to reduce the greenhouse gas emissions by 5% when you compare to 1990 level. When you compare to 1990 level of greenhouse gas emission, you have to reduce to 5%. These NHB countries. So when shall this be done? Between 2008 to 2012. During this time, the reduction has to happen. This is called the first commitment period of the Kyoto Protocol. Now come to the first question asked. They asked you about the market-based mechanism of Kyoto Protocol. See, basically, as the countries have to, the developed 37 countries have to reduce their emissions, first of all, they have to focus on their national policies. Nationally, they have to make strong policies to reduce the greenhouse gas emissions. However, as it may not be possible all the time, market-based mechanisms have been introduced. Now, broadly, three mechanisms are given by protocol. What are these three? First one is emission trading. Just like oil trading, for example, a country having more oil will trade it to the countries that do not have oil. For example, India importing the oil from Iran, like that. Similarly, emission trading means a country that is emitting the greenhouse gas less than what it is given for. For example, this country is allowed to emit 30 units of greenhouse gas, but it is emitting only 25 units. So still it can emit 5 more units, but it's not emitting. Now what happens? Take another country. This country has a limit of 30 units of greenhouse gas, but it has emitted 32 units. It emitted more. So it can purchase these 2 units from this country. Just like how you trade the commodities, you can trade the emission also. That's why we call them as carbon market. Like that, a flexible market-based mechanism has been introduced. This comes under Article 17 of Kyoto Protocol. Generally, no one remembers these articles, but if you mention, it will be better in the exam, Article 17. Similarly, the Article 12 of the Kyoto Protocol talks about clean developmental mechanism. Clean developmental mechanism means a NXB country can develop clean technology, can develop clean projects in developing countries. For example, USA can develop some clean power plants, some low emitting power plants projects in India. So why should USA develop such kind of products in India? To earn CER credits, certified emission reduction credits. So if USA can earn this, not only USA, any NXP country, if they can earn these CER credits, each credit will be equal to 1 ton of carbon dioxide, then they can emit that much more in their country. If they want to emit more in their country, they have to reduce it in some other country, developing country. So that is called clean developmental mechanism. The third market-based mechanism is joint implementation. Here, NXB countries only. One NXB country can collaborate with another NXB country, developed country, and together jointly they can implement a project where they can reduce the emissions. So understand broadly the point here is, if countries are unable to reduce the emission in their country, they can reduce the emission somewhere else, because throughout the world globally it is same greenhouse gas. So that is a fundamental concept. So that's why many countries started doing green investments in other countries, started building clean infrastructure because of these market-based mechanisms. The second part of the question is, what are various methods of monitoring the emission targets? Of course, Kyoto Protocol has fixed tough targets for the countries, tough emission targets. But what is the guarantee that those countries are following those emission targets? That's why monitoring is required, regular monitoring. For this monitoring, certain methods have been developed by the Kyoto Protocol. So they have developed a compliance system for transparency, so that entire world will know how much emissions are, how much emissions are released by each of these NXB countries. So a compliance system has been developed. There is a registry. The registry is maintained by United Nations Climate Change Secretariat, situated in the Bonn. So in that registry, all the countries' emissions will be registered every year, and accordingly, those countries will be warned if they are going beyond the limit. Also, every country has to report. There is a reporting system where every country has to annually report their emission inventories to the secretariat. So in this way, they are monitoring the emission targets. You can just add one point, it's an additional point, that even the UNFCCC has developed an adaptation fund. This fund will be used to develop the clean projects in developing countries which do not have enough funds. Now friends, the third part of the question, what is the Doha Amendment to the Kyoto Protocol? As you can see, the Kyoto Protocol is between 2008 to 2012. It is the first commitment period. So after that, what happens? After that, the second commitment period, 2013 to 2020, this has been added by Doha Amendment. Actually, Doha Amendment has done several amendments to Kyoto Protocol. However, you no need to write all those things. You have read just write 3 to 4 points. So you can say Doha Amendment added the second commitment period. Just as the Kyoto period ends at 2012, from 2013, this one starts. However, friends, this even today did not enter into the force, Doha Amendment. Why? Because for Doha Amendment to enter into the force, 144 parties have to accept it. Till now, some 137 parties only accepted it. Now, the Doha Amendment also revised the list of greenhouse gases. Normally, in the Kyoto Protocol, there are only 6 greenhouse gases. Like, you know, carbon dioxide, methane, nitrous oxide, like that. Only 6 gases are included as greenhouse gases. This Doha Amendment has revised the list of greenhouse gases and added more gases to that list. Also, as I told you, Kyoto Protocol, in the first commitment period, only 37 countries have committed to reduce the emissions. But in the Doha Amendment, several new countries of Annexure 1, new countries of Annexure 1, which were not there in the first commitment period, they also committed themselves to reduce the emissions in the second commitment period. And those commitments are also new commitments. For example, in the first commitment period, they decided to reduce 5% of emissions compared to 1990 level. However, in the second commitment period, they committed to reduce 18% of greenhouse gas emissions compared to the 1990 level. So, the next part of the question, compare the Paris Agreement with the Kyoto Protocol. See, as we saw in Kyoto Protocol, the first commitment period is still 2012, second commitment period is still 2020. That means by 2020, the Kyoto Protocol is completely ending. So what happens after that? That is why Paris Agreement happened in 2015 to continue the reduction of emissions after 2020. So Kyoto Protocol is still 2020, Paris Agreement after 2020. That's the main difference. However, there are some similarities. For example, both of them follow the principles of UNFCCC, both of them come under UNFCCC, and both of them are trying to reduce the global temperature by 2 degrees centigrade compared to the 1750 pre-industrial levels. Now friends, another major difference is, as I told you, Kyoto Protocol actually kept more burden on the developed countries which are historically responsible for polluting the world. So they're focused on developed countries, whereas Paris Agreement treats all countries equally. Even developing countries also comes under the Paris Agreement. Even countries like India and China also should cut the emissions according to the Paris Agreement. However, Kyoto Protocol is binding on those 37 countries. It's binding on NXP's countries. But Paris Agreement is voluntary. Every country voluntarily, they can tell how they will reduce the emissions and to what extent they can reduce. That voluntary nature is there in Paris Agreement. Even the monitoring mechanism of Kyoto Protocol is different from the Paris Protocol. Friends, in these kind of questions, as it is an international question, at least in the conclusion, you write about India. Essentially, we should bring India somewhere. So bring it in the conclusion. You can tell that India also committed to the Paris Agreement and we promised that by 2030, we will use 40% of the overall energy produced in India. We committed that 40% of the overall energy will be from non-fossil fuels. That means almost renewable energy, non-fossil. Because right now, in our energy composition, most of the energy producing from the fossil fuels only. So you want to reduce it. Second commitment India made is that we decided to create 3 billion tons of carbon sink. Carbon sink is absorption of carbon. To create 3 billion tons of carbon sink, we have to almost double the forest cover, and we committed to that. So in this way, you can end this answer. And the friends, and friends, see, as I told you about each question, just write 2 to 3 points. Just 2 to 3 points. Just see, 2 to 3 points, and no need to explain much. And as many facts you know, you can dump them. So the question for tomorrow, 23rd question, General Studies paper four, ethics. So you may be knowing in ethics generally they give quotation, but they will not mention whose quotation. You no need to know also. You no need to know who actually gave the quotation, whether Gandhi or somebody. For example, this quotation comes from Bodhidharma. But you no need to know that. If you know, you can mention Bodhidharma actually, yeah, you know, gave this quotation. However, in the question they asked you about, what do you mean? What do you mean by this statement? And what is the importance of this quotation in the present context? So write in two parts, 10 marks, 150 words. See you friends. Bye.